when I give a talk somewhere, I will get a question. Is anyone taking this seriously? Is anyone listening? Next time I get asked that question, I'll ask them to picture in their minds this room and Students for Global Health with the slogan on the back about a fair world with health equity, making health equity a reality. And I've often said that if on a cloudy, grey Thursday morning, my head should drop, I think of the students involved in Global Health, the International Federation of Medical Students Associations, and I feel happy all over again, feel optimistic about the future. So you are the reason for my evidence-based optimism, and it's great to see you all here. Thank you. And now, a special message to anyone who attended my lecture in Cambridge when I came up not so long ago to talk to the undergraduate medical students. If you did, there are two possibilities. One is you can get back on your smartphone and do what you normally do and while away the time while I'm talking. The other is you could concentrate really closely, and at the end I'll quiz you as to which slides I showed this evening I didn't show when I came last time. So let me start with a bit of evidence on, is anyone taking this seriously? As you heard, that's prompted in my talk, that's my Twitter handle. As you heard, I published The Health Gap, the opening lines of which were, why treat people and send them back to the conditions that made them sick. And I've spent a bit of time of late talking to doctors and medical associations, and this is my message to them. Why treat people and send them back to the conditions that made them sick? The Japanese translation, Korean translation, I like this one, the Italian one. Only the Italians would have me the Christ-like on the cover. And in fact, La Salute Disuguale, the Trento Festival of Economics, Trento in northern Italy, the Festival of Economics had as its theme a couple of summers ago, La Salute Disuguale. And they invited me to come and talk, and I'd quite forgotten that that was the theme of the meeting. And I arrived in Trento, beautiful small town in northern Italy, and there were these banners saying La Salute Disuguale. And I thought, that's the title of my book. And there was a cardboard cutout of me, and I had to have a photo taken next to the cardboard cutout. And I, SMS'd it to my kids, and one of them came back and said, I think the cutout looks better than the original. And I don't know where to put this on my CV, this, Crosswords of La Repubblica, 146 down, British physician, founder of social epidemiology. And the answer was Marmot. Now, there's no category on my curriculum vitae for this, but apart from my indulgence, it is a small indicator that people are taking these ideas seriously. And I looked a little while ago, I looked through my diary for a few months at the different groups that had asked me to come and talk about social determinants and health equity. Internal medicine, cardiology, respiratory disease, mental illness, obstetrics, cancer, surgery. Surgeons, the Royal Australasian College of Surgeons asked me to come and talk about social determinants. And the surgeons said that rheumatic heart disease is a disease of poverty, and that Indigenous Australians had the highest rate of rheumatic heart disease in the world. As medical students now in Cambridge, you never see a case of rheumatic heart disease. It is a disease of poverty, and it's still highly prevalent in Indigenous Australians. Child development, urban renewal, violence, inclusion, health, I mean, just, there's a lot of interest in honour in the ancient world. So, classicists at the University of Edinburgh have a European research project on honour in the ancient world, and they asked me to kick off their public lecture series. I saw a film about Alexander the Great, but what do I know about honour in the ancient world? They said, no, you talk about dignity and health. And we think that's very consistent with honour in the ancient world. Oh, and even public health. I tease myself that British civil servants are an odd group to form a basis for my thinking about global health. But what we found in the Whitehall studies of British civil servants was a social gradient. The higher you are in the social hierarchy, the better your health, the longer your life expectancy. And that social gradient turns out to be pretty well universal. We see it everywhere. Sticking with England for the moment, it's not just civil servants. Here we've got life expectancy for local areas. Each dot represents life expectancy for a small area, classified by level of deprivation. So to the right, as you look at it, you've got the most affluent, and to the left, the most deprived. And in a way, the striking finding is not that the most deprived have shorter life expectancy than the wealthy, but people near the top have shorter life expectancy than those at the top. People in the middle have shorter life expectancy than those near the top. It's a gradient that runs all the way from top to bottom, nationally, not just civil servants. The bottom graph is disability-free life expectancy. And the gradient is steeper. So it's not just length of life that's the issue, but quality of life. And this was figure one of the so-called Marmot Review, the review we did of health inequalities in England in 2010. And in my book, did I mention the health gap? In my book, the health gap. And since we did the review, Fair Society, Healthy Lives, we've been monitoring what's been happening to health and health inequalities and the social determinants of health. In 2017, we reported this. Life expectancy in England had been increasing about 1 year every 4 years since the end of World War I. So from 1921. To 2010, it was about 1 year every 4 years. That's amazing. 6 hours every 24 hours. That's truly astonishing. And that went on for 90 years in men and women, approximately. And then, in 2010, it stopped. A trend that had gone on for 90 years suddenly stopped. When we published this, I had a rather busy day, starting with the Today program, Radio 4, going around the news studios and whatever. And I got towards the end of the day, let me indulge, I was going to a dinner at the Royal Society of Medicine, a black tie dinner. And I was walking from my office in UCL to the Royal Society of Medicine via Broadcasting House to do yet one more interview. And I was really embarrassed walking through London in black tie and Cambridge, nobody could notice. I was really embarrassed. And then I was a bit crestfallen. Nobody paid any attention at all. But when I turned up at the BBC to do an interview, they took one look at my tuxedo and black tie, and they said, "That hasn't been de rigueur since about 1940. Used to be to broadcast on BBC radio, you had to wear a tuxedo. They stopped doing that." But I then looked at my Twitter, and the Secretary of State for Health had tweeted, "Respect, Marmot." There was no punctuation, so I didn't know if it was "respect, Marmot?" question mark. "Respect, Marmot. But since he was on the Today program this morning, life expectancy for men has increased by 61 minutes. I scratched my head and went back to him and said, "What are you saying?" I tweeted. "That the Office for National Statistics got its sums wrong? If ONS got it right, let's discuss." Somebody tweeted, "Ooh, Jeremy Hunt's picked a fight with Marmot. My money's on Marmot." In fact, I got to the RSM for this dinner. I was getting some award, and the new president, Simon Wesley, was making a speech, and he departed from his prepared text and referred to this Twitter exchange, and he said, "I never thought I would say this, but I feel a little bit sorry for Jeremy Hunt." Well, I wrote to him and said, "You should take this as seriously as you would a winter bed crisis. If health stopped improving, this is a health crisis." It's hard to put that in a letter. You could put it in capitals, I suppose. Anyway, I said, "You should take it as seriously as a winter bed crisis." And he did. He ignored them both. Which was not quite what I had in mind. One question that I was asked was, "Well, have we just reached peak life expectancy? Things have got to stop improving sometime." That's a reasonable question. If we look, you probably can't read it, so I'll describe it to you, the pale colours, so these are different European countries, the pale colours are 2006 to 2010, life expectancy increase, and the dark green is 2011 to 2015. And you can see that for almost every European country, this is women, but it's similar for men, for almost every European country, the latter period, 2011 to 15, the life expectancy increase was less than in the early period. And that's consistent with the global financial crisis and policies of austerity that were put in place right across Europe. But we, the United Kingdom, are the bottom. We had the most marked slowdown. So countries that already had better life expectancy than we did continued to have a bigger increase than we did. It is not the case that we had reached peak life expectancy. Simple comparison showed that. I was also asked, "Is this due to austerity?" And the answer is, it could be. I don't know. You might have imagined that if it were due to austerity, Greece would have had a more marked slowdown than we did. In fact, ours was worse than Greece. So I didn't want to jump to conclusions, but it's an important issue that we should be looking at. And the other issue is that health inequalities have been increasing. So not just has there been a slowdown, but health inequalities have been increasing. And that raises the question, is there anything government can do? And then, although we're talking about global health, I'm talking about the UK to start with, because I think we can learn a lot from a country like the UK that's got very high quality data and lots of research on these issues. So it gives us a lot of insight to the general question, is it possible to reduce health inequalities? Hasten to add that I'm not party political. Somebody just scoffed. brings us to the country. But if I talk about New Labour or policies of austerity, I'm talking about evidence. A senior politician said to me, I've been listening to the evidence you gave to the Scottish Parliament, and you're anti-government. And I said, no, I'm not. I'm anti-health inequalities. I'm pro-health equity. I'm against policies that are likely to make health inequalities worse. So when I asked the question, did New Labour have any beneficial effect on health inequalities? It's not a political question, it's a technical question. Can you do it? Colleagues at University of Liverpool looked at this question, and they looked at the gap between the 20% most deprived local authorities and the rest. And in the period before the New Labour strategy, 1983 to 2003. New Labour was elected in 97, and they elaborated, they did a review, elaborated a strategy, and there was a break in the curve around 2003. So in the period 83 to 2003, the gap, both for men and for women, the gap in life expectancy between the poorest 20% and the rest was increasing. During the period of the strategy to reduce health inequalities, the gap between the poorest 20% and the rest decreased. Then the coalition government was elected in 2010, took a while to ditch what the previous government had been doing, and the inequalities began to increase again. Yeah, it's not proof. But it's consistent with saying that it is possible to make a difference. I was sitting in Hong Kong in November, and I got a call from the BBC World Service in London saying that life expectancy in the US, that day's news, had now declined 3 years in a row. I had prepared this slide saying US life expectancy had declined 2 years in a row, but now 3 years in a row. And a big part of the increase is unintentional injuries. Unintentional injuries include drug overdose. In 2016, there were 63,600 unintentional injuries, mainly drug overdoses. In 2017, there were 70,000 in the US. These are opioid poisonings, largely. If you add to that 32,000 deaths from firearms, that's 100,000 deaths that really should not occur. Now, some of those firearm deaths are suicides, and it's likely that some of those suicides would have occurred anyway, but not all of them. It turns out it's easier to commit suicide if you've got a gun, and the suicide rate seems to go down where there are fewer guns. It's somehow more difficult to do it other ways. And that leads to the thought that the mind is an important gateway, not the only gateway, by which social determinants affect ill health. And let me think about global health for a moment. It's often said that we need to get the basics right. You know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. People need water and sanitation and food. And then we can worry about things like personal growth and control of your life. And I say, absolutely not. You need all those things at the same time. You don't wait, let's for the next few decades concentrate on getting clean water to people, and then we can worry about their quality of lives. No, we want to create the condition for people to have high quality lives at the same time as we're trying to meet the basics of food and water and sanitation and shelter. But the mind is an important gateway. Mental illness and well-being and psychosocial pathways to physical illness, behaviors and stress pathways. I said that the inequalities were increasing in the UK. And I've shown you that life expectancy declined 3 years in a row in the US. And this is really important. Just to repeat what I said, talking about the UK figures, we expect health to keep getting better. We've been schooled in that. It's going to get better every year. Things are going to get better. And they're not. They stop getting better in the UK, and they're getting worse in the United States. And what's happened to inequalities? This is life expectancy at age 50 for men in the United States. By year of birth. So people who were born in 1920 will be 50 in 1970. People who were born in 1950 will be 50 in 2000. And by deciles of income. So look at the people who were 50 born in 1920. You can see the social gradient, bottom 10%, next 10%, it's a gradient. Now look what happened over that 30-year period. Life expectancy scarcely improved for the bottom 10%. It improved a bit more for the next 10%, a bit more, a bit more, a bit more. So the inequalities got much bigger. The social gradient got much steeper. And overall, life expectancy declined in large measure because the inequalities were getting bigger. Now, I don't want to spoil your evening by showing you the next slide, but you look as though you're resilient. Perhaps I ought to get informed consent before I show you the next slide. This is men. The next one is women. You ready? This is truly awful. Life expectancy is going down for the bottom 10%. It's going down for the next 10%. It's going down for the third decile. For the bottom 30%, life expectancy is decreasing. That orange nightmare in the White House keeps boasting that the US is the best it's ever been. Does he know what's going on? Does he know about the people killing themselves? Does he know that for women, the bottom 30% of the income distribution, life expectancy is going down? And if he knew, did he care? My view is that health equity, the magnitude of health inequalities, tells us something fundamental about the nature of society. And society is not going very well in the United States. And we're not doing terribly well in the UK either. And what can we do about all this? I chaired the WHO Commission on Social Determinants of Health. We put on the cover of our report, social injustice is killing on a grand scale. Slightly unusual for a WHO report to say that. And we put at the heart of what we were trying to achieve, empowerment, having control over your life. And we said empowerment had three dimensions. Material, if you can't afford to feed your children, you can't be empowered. Psychosocial, having control over your life. And political, having voice. We said, we want to improve the conditions in which people are born, grow, live, work, and age, and deal with the inequities in power, money, and resources that give rise to these inequities in the conditions of daily life. Fiona had said and I share something in common. In the wake of the Global Commission, Fiona was the Deputy Chief Medical Officer and was instrumental in commissioning me to conduct the English review, which we called Fair Society, Healthy Lives. And it was an attempt to answer the question, you've done this global commission, how could we apply your findings and recommendations to one country, England? And then I was commissioned by the regional director of WHO for Europe, Susanna Yaka, to conduct the European review of social determinants and the health divide in the European region. And literally today, tomorrow, the day after, we're completing, I've been leading the commission of the Pan American Health Organization on equity and health inequalities in the Americas. We published our executive summary, Health Equity and Dignified Lives, and I'll be happy next time you invite me back to tell you about the findings of our PAHO Commission in the Americas. And it's the whole of the Americas. It's North, Central, South, and the Caribbean. I want to divert for a moment and ask you to keep a second idea in your head. Two ideas is a bit much for one lecture, but let's try it. And the second idea relates to crime. In The Health Gap, in the book, I talked about Baltimore. And I contrasted two parts of Baltimore, Upton Druid Heights in Baltimore's inner city, and Roland Park, lovely green leafy area. Life expectancy for men in Upton Druid was 63, and in Roland Park, 83. So if you lived in Roland Park, where the Johns Hopkins professors tend to live, and you wanted to see what it was like to live in a place where life expectancy was 20 years shorter, you could fly to Ethiopia. Alternatively, you could go a few kilometers across town and see Roland Park and see Upton Druid. I talked about the differences between Upton Druid and Roland Park, single parent families for half the kids, median household income was $17,000. 90% of the kids did not go on to college. But look at this. Each year, a third of young people aged 10 to 17 are arrested for a juvenile disorder. A third each year, which means the majority will have a criminal record by the age of 17. In theory, the slate is wiped clean at 18. So you go for a job and you get asked, have you ever been in trouble with the police? You could lie, which is not a very good qualification for a job, except for getting to the White House. Or you could tell the truth. Yeah, I've been arrested many times, which is not a great qualification for a job. And in 2005, 2009, there were 100 non-fatal shootings for every 10,000 residents and nearly 40 homicides. In Roland Park, juvenile arrests, 1 in 50 each year, no non-fatal shootings, 4 homicides, not 40. So we've got this correlation, poor health and crime concentrated in the same areas, good health and low crime rates in the more affluent areas. And I'm not suggesting that ill health causes crime or crime causes ill health, but I think they may have common causes. And I was thinking about this when I got as I have been intermittently, engaged in the question of health of Indigenous Australians. Australia ranks number 2 or number 3 in the UN Human Development Index. If Australian Aboriginals were treated as a separate country, they would rank 115 in the Human Development Index. So there you have the richest, arguably nearly the richest, most developed country in the world, with the original residents of that country, with the Human Development Index something like 114 places lower. When I get invited these days to Australia, I always ask, can I visit some Indigenous communities? So I went to Alice Springs last year. This is downtown Arayonga. If you think Alice Springs is pretty basic, Arayonga is 2 hours drive from Alice Springs. Downtown Arayonga has a council office, a store, and a health clinic. Parenthetically, when I went to the health clinic, they showed me with pride the prevention advice they give to the residents, how to have a healthy diet to prevent overweight and diabetes. Eat lots of fruit. Do you know how much an apple costs in Alice Springs, let alone getting an apple out in Arayonga? There is no economic activity in Arayonga. How are people supposed to eat a piece of fruit? And then back in Alice Springs, the biggest building, probably can't see that very well, is the Supreme Court of the Northern Territory. Looms over the whole town, the Supreme Court. Why? The incarceration rate for Indigenous Australians in the Northern Territory of Australia is 2,400 per 100,000. For non-Indigenous residents of the Northern Territory, it's 186 per 100,000. A 13-fold difference. 84% of the prison population in the Northern Territory is Indigenous, whereas the general population, 27%. Diagnosed mental illness in prisoners, 72% in men, 92% in women. Can you think of a worse possible place to put someone with mental illness than a prison? If they didn't have mental illness when they went in, it's highly likely they will when they come out, if they get out. And just to put it in context, the non-Indigenous incarceration rate is 186, 2,400 in Indigenous. Japan, it's 48 per 100,000. The UK, it's about 148. And the USA, it's 700. They like putting people away in the US. And of course, what was that word that woman used? Tinged? Was that she used on the BBC yesterday? It's racially, it's not tinged. It's very heavily racially imbued. It is stark racial prejudice in the United States. They lock up people of colour. And as in the Northern Territory of Australia, if you're a white and you get stopped and the cop thinks you might have been drinking, and the Northern Territory of Australia says, next time I'll have you, you shouldn't be doing that. And if you're black, prison. Elias Nostrati, who's sitting there, looked at incarceration rates as a determinant of health. And here we've got life expectancy, US states, life expectancy in the bottom income quartile by the state level incarceration rate. So if you look at the five states with the lowest incarceration rate compared with the five states with the highest incarceration rate, for people in the bottom income quartile, they have higher life expectancy where the incarceration rate is low. Now you could ask, and I hope you would ask, is that the incarceration rate that's doing it, or is it the kind of state that tends to put people away? And that's a perfectly reasonable question, and Elias and his colleagues spent quite a lot of time trying to answer that question. And it's at least consistent with saying that the incarceration rate is not just damaging the individuals who get incarcerated, it may be having a damaging effect on the community. And after we did that, I was talking to a director of public health for a prison in Australia, and he said to me, oh yeah, we know that, build a prison and health gets worse in the surrounding community. So, crime and mental illness, I'm not an expert in this, so I've had a look at some of the literature. I found in Denmark, in males who were guilty of violent offending, 10% had mental illness. In females guilty of violent offending, 26% had mental illness. UK estimate, 80% of all criminal activity is attributable to people who had conduct problems in childhood and adolescence. So I don't know whether the right figure is 10% mental illness in prisoners or 80% mental illness in prisoners. Either way, it's a lot. And if mental illness is getting you into prison, then if we can prevent mental illness, not only would we be improving people's health, we might actually be reducing the incarceration rate. Ah, I asked you to keep two ideas, health and crime. Maybe it's only one idea because they're linked. So let's prevent mental illness in children. And in my English review, we had six domains of recommendations. Give every child the best start in life. Education and lifelong learning, employment and working conditions, having enough money to live on, healthy and sustainable places in which to live and work, and taking a social determinants approach to prevention. So, give every child the best start in life. I said that we've been monitoring health inequalities and social determinants. And one of the measures we've been looking at is the percent of children age 5 that have a good level of development. If you look at the blue dots, ignore the red dots for the moment, look at the blue dots. What that shows, each dot is a local authority classified by degree of deprivation. So as you look at it, to the right you've got the least deprived, to the left the most deprived, and it shows a very clear relation. The more affluent the local authority, the higher the proportion of children age 5 with a good level of development. One strategy to reduce inequalities in early child development is to reduce poverty and deprivation. It's a gradient, so you don't want to focus only on the bottom, but bring the bottom up towards the middle. In fact, you'd like to bring the middle up towards the top. So reduce poverty and inequality. But you'll notice they scatter around the line. For a given level of deprivation, some local authorities are doing better than others. Ah, how do you break the link? Because if we think globally, there are a lot of poor people in the world. We'd like to improve their income, but we'd also like to break the link between low income and poor early child development. Now, look at the red dots. The red dots are poor children. These are children eligible for free school meals. It's a means-tested benefit, so these are the poorer children. And the graph goes the other way. The poorer children are doing better in poorer areas. The opposite of what I predicted. I got this completely wrong. The difference between being a scientist and a politician is, as a scientist, you have to admit when you get it wrong. A politician, you just bluster and pretend that you really said that all along. Anyway, I got it completely wrong. I thought poor kids would do worse in poor areas. They don't. They do better in poor areas. So look at this. Look at the English figures. 60% of children at the end of reception had a good level of development. And the children eligible for free school meals, it was just under 45%. The gap is just under 16%. Then we went to Hackney in East London. It is rapidly gentrifying. My daughter just moved into a flat in Hackney, but as I walked from Hackney Central to her flat, I thought, it's not completely gentrified. It looked pretty dodgy, I have to say. Daddy's allowed to worry. There are a lot of poor children around. Look what they're doing. Just under 61% of the poor children eligible for free school meals have a good level of development, the same as the English average. The gap between the poor children and the average in Hackney is only 4%. In Hackney, they've broken the link between deprivation and poor early child development. And if we looked at GCSE results, it would look the same. There is a London effect. If you ask them, what are you doing in Hackney? You get different answers. One is they spend more money per child in London. There is a London effect, and it relates in part to funding. Fund early childhood, preschool, school, you get better results. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? More money, you get better results. That's not bad. And what about Bath and North East Somerset? Lovely Georgian Bath. What are they doing? More to the point, what are they not doing? My guess is, and I don't know this, but my guess is, if you ask them, what do you do for poor children in Bath? They say, poor children? We didn't know we had any. When you don't have very many, perhaps you don't focus. In Hackney, if they don't focus on poor children, they're not doing their job. And I said the other way is to reduce poverty. If we look at child poverty, defined as less than 60% median income, you really can't read that at all, so I'll tell you what it says. In the Nordic countries, in Denmark, Iceland, Norway, Finland, child poverty is 9, 10, 11%. So around 10% of children live in households with less than 60% of the median income. In the UK, it's 19%. In the United States, it's 29%, just below Mexico, which is 31%. Child poverty is not somehow God-given. It is under control of the Minister of Finance. The Minister of Finance can decide what the child poverty rate should be. In the Nordic countries, if you compare pre-tax and post-tax, they reduce child poverty by about 2/3. I've been talking implicitly here about the good side of early childhood, nurturing, care by parents and others. The bad side is adverse child experiences, ACEs. And each of these adverse child experiences, incarceration, drug abuse, sexual abuse, alcohol abuse, domestic abuse, physical abuse, mental illness, and the like, each of them follows the social gradient. The lower families are, in terms of income or deprivation, the higher the frequency of adverse child experiences. And these really matter. Mark Bellis in Wales has estimated that if you could prevent 4 or more adverse child experiences, you could reduce early sex by 1/3, unintended teen pregnancy by 38%, smoking, binge drinking, cannabis use. Look at this, violence perpetration. If you could prevent people having 4 or more ACEs, adverse child experiences, you could reduce violence perpetration by 1/2. And 1/2 the victims of domestic violence had 4 or more adverse child experiences. So you can see how these unfortunate effects get transmitted across the generations. Relative deprivation leads to increased adverse child experiences, lead to bad outcomes, including incarceration in the next generation, and then that reproduces itself in the generation after. If we look at wealth inequality in OECD countries, the top 1%, how much the top 1% earn, how much wealth they have, in that's the United States, where the top 1% have more than 40% of the total wealth, and that was 2010, and that's 2014. That concentration is growing. And Oxfam's latest report, 26 billionaires have the same wealth as the bottom 3.8 billion people, the bottom 1/2 of the global population, 26 billionaires. We think Jeff Bezos is a hero at the moment because he's fighting back against Trump and Pecker and those ghastly people. But has anyone kept track of how many billions he has? $150 billion or something ridiculous? Starbucks was summoned before the Public Accounts Committee of the Parliament and asked, why don't you pay tax in Britain? They said, we don't make a profit. Ah, oh, isn't that kind of Starbucks? They're operating as a kind of charity to the coffee. Isn't that kind? How come you don't make a profit? Well, we buy our coffee beans from the Netherlands. What? I've been to the Netherlands. No coffee beans in the Netherlands. They grow tulips, they're cows. They're no coffee beans. Coffee's grown in Ethiopia and Costa Rica and Brazil and Colombia. How come they grow coffee beans? They don't grow coffee beans in the Netherlands. They grow accountants. So Starbucks buys, they cost a lot of money to buy our coffee beans from the Starbucks-owned company in the Netherlands, which is just a dodge to avoid paying tax because you have to pay all this money. Well, it costs a lot because they don't grow them there. If we dealt with tax avoidance for the UK, 12.7 billion euros a year, that's kind of the same order of magnitude of that lie that was on the side of the red bus, £350 million a week, that would be £18.2 billion a year. We could actually fund our NHS just by reducing multinationals' tax avoidance. It would be helpful to be part of some common market or community or something. That's all bad news. Let me tell you the good news. Coventry is a marmot city. Coventry took my 6 domains of recommendations from the English Review and said, let's apply them. And they're starting to look at whether they've done any good. They tell me that the percent of children aged 5 with a good level of development has gone up. The proportion of young people aged 18 to 24 not in employment, education, or training has gone down. The proportion of people who are earning the minimum wage has gone up. Oh, it's good. So I've been talking to Gateshead, we're talking to Manchester about becoming a marmot city. I'm told there are 6 cities and regions in Sweden that have done their own marmot reviews, in Malmö, Linköping, Norrköping, Gothenburg, Östersund, where they've taken my reports and said, how can we apply these at city level? So where we're not getting action at national level, we can get action at city level. I was invited to Trieste. I was told it was an Italian marmot city. Going to Bologna next week, same invitation. I finally cottoned on to this. I said, do Trieste and Bologna know that they're Italian marmot cities? Oh no, we just said that to get you here. Okay. But still, they're doing it. They're actually getting social services and education and health services together at the city to look at the social determinants of health. I went to a shed in Western Sydney. This shed was set up to prevent Aboriginal men from committing suicide. When I was taken there, the founder of this service, and it is a shed, the founder of this service said, this is dedicated to you. I said, to me, what do you mean? He said, the conventional wisdom was that men get depressed because they don't talk about their feelings. We took a different approach. We said men get depressed and suicidal because of the social determinants of health, because of poverty and lack of shelter. And I was told one harrowing story after another of child removal, isolation, depression. The default position of the care services in Australia is that Australian Aboriginals are not capable of being parents. So the default position is remove the children from the parents. And taking children into care has disastrous consequences for the children and pretty bad outcomes for the parents. These men were suicidal. Isolated. I met one elder of the community, a woman, who said her oldest son, she'd had 6 sons, her oldest son, drugs, alcohol, children removed, committed suicide. And her youngest son was a death in custody, which is epidemic in Australia. Young Aboriginal men in prison die, and it's never quite clear whether they've been beaten to death or committed suicide, or beaten and then committed suicide. But these mysterious deaths in custody, which are epidemic. But the shed set up to do something about it. And we've already got a network in the Americas ready to take forward the findings of our PAHO Commission. I want to come back to the Australian issue. When I was invited to Australia to give some lectures for the ABC, the Radio, the Australian Broadcasting Commission. The Australian Medical Association wrote to me and said, can we help you? And I said, yeah, I'd like to see doctors in action on the social determinants of health. Well, for the reasons I've said, they're very concerned about the health gap between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Australians. 10.6 years for men, 9.4 years for women. And they took me to an Aboriginal community control centre. They had doctors working at this centre, of course. I was taken to the area for antenatal classes. They had this belly cast program. So Aboriginal women don't attend antenatal classes. The way they attract them in is to take plaster casts of their pregnant torsos and decorate them with Aboriginal art. And they're really lovely. And the women love it. And they're attracted to come in. And then once they're in, they attend the antenatal classes, help with pregnancy and childbirth, and then postnatal. The children all attend, and the families, some sort of evaluated program for improving parenting and child outcomes. And then dealing with drugs and alcohol. And for older people, it says grannies against removal. So the grandmas saying, don't take our children away. As I said, the default position is removing kids from the family. I said I was invited to give these lectures for ABC. And they had me on the ABC version of Question Time. I call it Q&A, but it's the same thing. And the convener asked me to say something about income inequality. And I asked, what do the following groups have in common? The 48 million people who make up the population of Tanzania, the 7 million people who make up the population of Paraguay, the 2 million people who make up the population of Latvia, and the 25 top earning hedge fund managers in New York. And the answer is the previous year, each of those groups had a combined income of around $25 billion. Imagine, I said, that the hedge fund managers gave up their income for 1 year. They wouldn't miss it. They're going to make $1 billion each the next year. And we transferred that $25 billion to Tanzania. You double the per capita income. And I'm not suggesting simply giving it to individual Tanzanians, although that would not be such a bad thing to do. But think of the clean water you could pipe to villages, the clean cook stoves, the nurses and teachers. And another member of the panel said, you're in fantasy land, mate. That's never gonna happen. You're in complete fantasy land. I was a bit shocked. But the next day was when I went to the Tharawal Aboriginal Community Health Centre, and one of the doctors had a sign saying, so, students, colleagues, I say to you, welcome to my fantasy land. And as the back of your t-shirts say, let's dream of a world of greater fairness